Good morning, faith family, church friends and visitors. Welcome to this morning's worship service. For the call to worship this morning, I would like to do something a little different. I would, rather than using a passage from the scripture, I would like to use the words from a song, God is Able, written by Mosey Lister. During this time of uncertainty in our country and the world, I believe the words from this song speak clearly to us. I will be using the words from the first verse in the chorus. And the words go like this. People, do you know there's trouble all over this land? Sorrow and grief, and we don't understand. We ought to be on our knees today. Ought to cry, Lord, won't you show us the way? Crying to the Lord, won't you lend us a helping hand? Don't you know that God, our God, never fails? Oh no, he never fails. No matter what the case may be, God never fails. When all the world is going wrong, just keep on holding on. For he is able, he is God, and God never fails. These words give us the assurance that God is in control of all things and his way is perfect. He knows the hearts of those who have lost loved ones to the coronavirus. He knows the hearts of those who have tested positive to the virus. He knows the hearts of all of those who are caring for those who have the virus and all the sacrifices that they have made with all the extra work that they are doing to keep the virus from spreading even further. He knows my heart, and he knows your heart. We have many questions, and through all of this, God has the answers. We just need to trust him, take his hand, and he will lead us in the way he wants us to go and according to his timeline. Let's just praise him for how he has led us in the past, and he will continue to lead us in the future. Just remember, he is able, he is God, and God never fails.
Let us now go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Our good and gracious God, you are the Father of lights, in whom there is no shadow or variation due to change. Your love doesn't change. Your wisdom doesn't change. Your promises don't change. Your grace never changes. Father, all that you have granted for us is sure, because you are the God who never changes. You are perfectly and always God, in all of your holiness and glory forever and ever. And yet we also readily recognize that we are the ones who change. We make promises that we don't keep. We keep your word one day and fail the next. Our passion wavers. Our love for others is inconstant. Our holiness comes and goes. We are frail. We are feeble. We are weak. We are sinful. And yet, even as we confess, we know that we have life in you, because you, as the unchanging God, have sent forth your Son in deep and fatherly love for us, so that we have a gracious and forgiving Savior. Forgive us, O God, and help us to see our Savior for all that he is for us, knowing that he's the one who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And as we confess these things, we already know that our sins are forgiven in him. We thank you, we praise you, and now prepare us to hear your word, for we pray in Christ's name. Amen. And as we are those who confess our sins, we also know of God's good news from 1 John 1:8-9 today. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So let us not cling to our sin or hide it as though it doesn't exist, but let us confess our sins and know that as we do so, our God forgives us in and through his Son. And now, as we go on to hear from God's word, I'm going to hand it over to the Velsky home as they bring us the children's message this morning.
Good morning, guys. So this week we are going to finish our story about Naomi and Ruth. So if you guys remember last week, we met Ruth and Naomi and Boaz, and this week we actually have a new character to introduce to our story.
The weird thing about this new character is he doesn't even have a name. He's just called Redeemer in the story, but he's a really important piece of the puzzle. So we're going to think about finishing this story like when you finish a puzzle. It's really important to have all the pieces so you know what the final picture looks like. Our life is kind of like a puzzle, and God uses all the pieces of our puzzle to finish our story, just like he's doing for Naomi. At the beginning of the story, Naomi was feeling pretty bitter and sad. Things weren't going very well for her. She hadn't followed God's plan for her life, and she lost her husband, she lost her sons, and she was stuck alone with two daughters-in-law and no way to support them. So she was feeling pretty sad, and she actually felt like God had left her, like he wasn't even helping her. She was bitter. She was very, very sad. And she decided to return to her hometown of Bethlehem. Now, on the way, one daughter-in-law decided to go back to her family, but her daughter, Ruth, decided that she was going to stay with her. And Naomi thought that that was pretty wonderful. What Naomi didn't realize is that Ruth choosing to stay with her was part of God, was God working a part of his plan to put the puzzle together for Naomi. When they got to Bethlehem, the puzzle grew a little bit more.
So when they got to Bethlehem, they met Boaz. And Boaz was the kinsman redeemer for their family. So he was the guy who was going to come in and he was going to help them and support them and get them food and a home and just care for them.
And what you might notice is the puzzle should be fitting together a little better, but Naomi wasn't quite sure that things were still going great. Her bitterness still hadn't turned to complete joy. But when Boaz realized what Ruth was doing for Naomi, he started to do some really good things for Ruth and Naomi and their family, and he wanted to take care of them. And Naomi could see this goodness, and she knew that Boaz was the man to help them. So her bitterness started to turn to joy, and their puzzle fit even better. However, we're going to find out this week that in order for Ruth and Boaz to be able to be married, there is a redeemer that is closer to Ruth, and this man has to either decide to marry Ruth or step out of the way before Boaz can marry Ruth and become the true redeemer of the family. But you would think that this is a problem, but God is working his plan. He's piecing this puzzle together, and where this could be an issue, God had a plan for this redeemer too. And this redeemer, this man with no name, decides that he doesn't want to marry Ruth. So now Boaz has permission to marry Ruth, and God's pieces of the puzzle are together and they fit perfectly. And Naomi can see that God has actually been working in her life the whole time. And he has put all these pieces together, and Ruth and Boaz and Naomi, God is showing how much he loves them and how faithful he is to all of them and how he had the perfect plan for each of them. Sometimes, boys and girls, we think that we have the perfect plan for our life, but in actuality, God has the perfect plan for our life. And even when things don't go our way, like things didn't go the right way for Naomi and her family to begin with, because they took their plans into their own hands, God still will take his plans and he will turn them out for the good because we love him so much. It's pretty amazing.
So in this story, God's like the puzzle master. He is the one who could fit all of our pieces together. So even when life isn't quite going how we want it to, or things didn't go as planned, God is still working in our story for the puzzle pieces to come together and for us to have good things in our lives and to work out for our good and for his glory.
Let's pray, boys and girls. Heavenly Father, thank you for being a God who loves us no matter what. And even when things aren't going our way and things seem dark and sad, we know that you are working for our good because we love you so much. Thank you for taking the pieces of our puzzle and putting them together and for loving us no matter what. In your name we pray, amen.
We have now come to the last chapter in Ruth today. We're going to be in Ruth chapter 4. And sometimes when you see a preview to, say, a final movie in a series or a series finale of a show or Game 7 of the NBA Finals, when you see a preview of that final, the finale of the series or the game, a lot of times you'll hear something like, it's all been leading to this. And today, that's really what we have to say about Ruth chapter 4. Every week as I preach from earlier sections in Ruth, I feel pulled to the end, to the conclusion, because it makes the first three chapters that much better. And it even lifts our eyes as we see chapter 4 to new heights of God's grace. We've been seeing this start to play out in recent weeks as we have seen that behind Ruth's care for Naomi and Boaz's care for Ruth and Naomi and Naomi's care for Ruth, that God, the God of steadfast love, is working to bless his people. But today, it explodes into a wonderful climax of grace and redemption that reveals the height and breadth and depth and width of God's love for us. This is what we're going to be seeing in Ruth chapter 4. And we ended last week seeing how there was a redeemer closer to Naomi than Boaz. Boaz was not going to rest until he resolved the matter of redeeming Ruth and Naomi. And remember that redemption and needing a redeemer, it had to do with the fact that they needed someone to buy back their land, their property from them. So a redeemer was a close relative who could buy someone's land for them or buy them out of slavery or even, as we have seen, provide an offspring for them. When there was a widow who didn't have a child and an heir, a redeemer could marry the widow and provide an offspring. And so that's what we've been seeing. And as Ruth was talking to Boaz in chapter 3, we found that she proposed to him, knowing that he could be the one to redeem her and Naomi, and Boaz accepted the proposal. But since there was a redeemer closer in relation to Naomi than he was, chapter 3 ended with Boaz on a mission to see whether this closer relative would redeem Ruth and Naomi. And so today we begin chapter 4 with Boaz at the city gate, rearing and ready to go and resolve the issue. And so with that said, if you have your Bibles, open to Ruth 4, and we'll go ahead and read God's word. Now Boaz had gone up to the gate and sat down there. And behold, the Redeemer, of whom Boaz had spoken, came by. So Boaz said, "Turn aside, friend, sit down here." And he turned aside and sat down. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, "Sit down here." So they sat down. Then he said to the Redeemer, "Naomi, who has come back from the country of Moab, is selling the parcel of land that belonged to our relative Elimelech. So I thought I would tell you of it and say, buy it in the presence of those sitting here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, redeem it. But if you will not, tell me, that I may know, for there is no one besides you to redeem it, and I come after you." And he said, "I will redeem it." Then Boaz said, "The day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead, in order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance." Then the Redeemer said, "I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I impair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot redeem it." Now this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging. To confirm a transaction, the one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other, and this was the manner of attesting in Israel. So when the Redeemer said to Boaz, "Buy it for yourself," he drew off his sandal. Then Boaz said to the elders and all the people, "You are witnesses this day that I have bought from the hand of Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion and Mahlon. Also Ruth the Moabite, the widow of Mahlon, I have bought to be my wife, to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brothers and from the gate of his native place. You are witnesses this day." Then all the people who were at the gate and the elders said, "We are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. May you act worthily in Ephrathah and be renowned in Bethlehem. And may your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah, because of the offspring that the Lord will give you by this young woman." So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And he went in to her, and the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Then the women said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without a redeemer, and may his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age, for the daughter-in-law who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has given birth to him." Then Naomi took the child and laid him on her lap and became his nurse. And the women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi." They named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now these are the generations of Perez. Perez fathered Hezron. Hezron fathered Ram. Ram fathered Amminadab. Amminadab fathered Nashon. Nashon fathered Salmon. Salmon fathered Boaz. Boaz fathered Obed. Obed fathered Jesse. And Jesse fathered David. This is God's word. Let us pray. We do ask you, O God, that you would open the eyes of our hearts to behold wonderful things from your word, that you would speak in and through Ruth 4 for us to see all that you have done for us and continue to do for us, especially in the person of Christ. For it's in him that we pray. Amen. We find as the book closes here that it's through God's gracious redemption that emptiness gives way to fullness, that death gives way to life, that bitterness gives way to joy, as God weaves the steadfast love of his people into his eternal purposes of salvation and blessing. And ultimately, what we'll see is that as God's gracious redemption has come to us through Christ, we will see that he also fills us with grace as well, and weaves all of our steadfast love and all of the stuff of our lives into his eternal purposes, just as we see here. And for us to grasp the magnificence of this reality, of this book, and of this culminating chapter, we really need to see three specific things. Number one, the emptiness of self-seeking. Number two, the fullness of steadfast love. And number three, the wisdom of sovereign grace. And so in the first place, we really must see the emptiness of self-seeking. In verse 1, as Boaz is looking for this other redeemer, we read that he had gone up to the gate and sat down there. The town gate was where you would conduct business in that day. And specifically, you would get the elders of the city together if you wanted to make legal transactions, and that's what Boaz is doing here, waiting for this other redeemer to arrive at the city gate. And then in verse 2, by God's providence, we find that the redeemer of whom Boaz had spoken came by. And so Boaz said, "Turn aside, friend, and sit down here." And he turned aside and sat down. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, "Sit down here." And then they sat down. It was normal to have specifically 10 elders of the city to witness and verify a legal transaction. And so Boaz, being a worthy man, didn't have a problem getting certain elders to sit down and to be participants in what was about to take place. And in their presence, he put the issue on the table in verse 3. Telling the Redeemer that Naomi is looking to have the land that belonged to Elimelech redeemed. And he calls the man in verse 4 to buy the land in the presence of those sitting here and in the presence of the elders of my people, all in order to redeem it. Now, this might be a touch confusing to us because we don't have the same laws in our day. But in short, Elimelech probably sold the land of the inheritance to someone outside the clan before they went to Moab for a few decades. But because the land was their inheritance, they still had claims to it. It was still Elimelech's land. Naomi still had a claim to it. So if they had money, the people who bought it from Elimelech before they went to Moab would have to sell it back. The problem here and throughout Ruth is twofold. Number one, Naomi doesn't have money. They have nothing. They're impoverished. They're destitute. But even more important, she is also a woman. And as a woman, she did not have the rights to buy it back. The land inheritance could only be claimed by a man in the family. And so what Boaz is putting on the table here is the opportunity of a close male relative, one who would be a kinsman redeemer, to buy back the land of Elimelech so that it could stay within their extended family and then be cultivated to provide for Naomi. To stay within the family and provide for Naomi. Those are the two things that are at play here. And interestingly, the Redeemer says, "I will redeem it." And you don't necessarily expect this when you're reading. You want Boaz to redeem it, and yet he says he's going to redeem it. But we do have to understand that there's a degree in which this makes total sense in that day. Because after putting money up for the field and then providing for Naomi, the money that was earned from the field would be his. And since there wasn't an heir in Naomi's family, since Elimelech was dead and the sons were dead, after she passed away, the land would then be passed on to this close relative's family. It would be part of the inheritance that he would give to his sons. So this is a pretty good deal for him. And he decides that he will go ahead and redeem it until he hears about Ruth in verse 5. Because then Boaz said, "The day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead, in order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance." Boaz is mentioning here something that we've seen in recent weeks from Deuteronomy 25, the call of a redeemer to provide a son for his brother's widow. And as we mentioned, Boaz is not a brother of Malon. And neither is this closer relative a brother of Malon. But what he is calling this redeemer, potential redeemer, to do is to embody the spirit of the law, to show steadfast love, to redeem and fulfill the call of Deuteronomy 25, even though he wasn't necessarily a brother. The purpose is to produce an heir so that the name of Elimelech would not be cut off, and the land would stay within the family and pass on from generation to generation through this heir. But for this relative, this is a harder pill to swallow. Because if Ruth has a son, this land that he is to redeem would not have stayed in his family. It would be the land of Ruth's son, the heir. And even more than that, he may now be responsible to provide some of his own possessions to this new son. And so he responds in verse 6, "I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I impair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot redeem it. See, he saw the cost involved, the sacrifice that he's being called to, and it was too much. Sacrificial love was not something that he wanted to give, and he put his immediate earthly concerns above God's call to redeem them out of poverty and need. See, he was willing to redeem when it was easy. He was willing to follow the Lord and love others when it didn't cost him much, but not when it called him to make a sacrifice. But as we have seen already throughout the book of Ruth, and as we see all throughout Scripture, love by definition is costly. It involves sacrifice. It's costly for a husband to love his wife sacrificially when she's not talking very nice to him. It's hard for a wife to follow her husband when she doesn't think he's taking her into account and making plans. It's costly for students to be kind toward that classmate who's always ripping on you and you just want to give him a jab back. And it's costly when you yourself sin against somebody and have to go to them and swallow your pride and ask for forgiveness in humility. It's costly when you have to give your time and energy to people. See, loving people takes sacrifice. It may mean that we miss a baseball game to have an important conversation with someone in our home. It may mean that we need to give of our money that we've been saving for a vacation when we see a need. It may mean letting go of a grudge and forgiving others as Christ has forgiven us. See, true and genuine love, sacrificial love, steadfast love, is not seen most in the good times. It's seen in the difficult times. It's seen when it costs something of us. Because by definition, as we read in 1 Corinthians 13, love does not seek its own way. It does not insist on its own way. But for this potential redeemer here, he couldn't go there. He did insist on his own way. He was self-seeking. And so he could not get out of himself to show steadfast love to Ruth and Naomi. And the irony of this is that he ended up, even though he didn't want to take a hit himself, he ended up taking a bigger hit. Because as one writer puts it, in protecting his legacy, his stuff, he is forfeiting a much better legacy. As we will see, this is all going toward that genealogy at the end of the book that leads to David and ultimately leads to Christ, so that Boaz and Ruth are King David's great-grandparents. They're even ancestors of Christ himself. But because this man's afraid of obeying God's word because of what it's going to cost him, because it's going to take away from his legacy, he misses out on a place in God's eternal purposes of salvation. In fact, he even goes nameless. This whole chapter is chock full of names with a genealogy at the end. And everybody in the chapter, all the individuals of the chapter, are named except for him. In fact, when Boaz calls him to turn aside in verse 1, he even calls him friend, which could be translated so-and-so, so that some commentators just go on calling him Mr. So-and-so. That's all that he ends up being, because of his failure to show steadfast love to those who he was called to. So that while we remember Elimelech, whose name this man didn't care to preserve, we don't know his name. It's lost in the annals of history. He missed, you see, what Ruth understood. He missed what Boaz and even Naomi came to understand, that if you seek to save your life, you lose it. Faithfulness is hard, and love is costly. And if you go the way of Mr. So-and-so and give your life over to ease, to pleasure, to self-seeking, without concern for what God calls you to, then the end result, as we find here, is oblivion and namelessness. You become another Mr. So-and-so, choosing the wide and easy path of destruction, being left even to your own devices and standing before the judgment seat of Christ. But when we entrust ourselves, our lives, to the living God, instead of seeking our own, when we seek to follow him and humility and faithfulness, not perfection, but genuinely falling before the Lord and seeking to please him in faithfulness, we find that it's worth it. The one who loses their life for Christ's sake will find it. And this is what we see next in our next point in Ruth chapter 4, that we also need to see not only the emptiness of self-seeking, but also the fullness of steadfast love. In the first three chapters, we have seen the steadfast love of Ruth for Naomi and Boaz for both Ruth and Naomi, and even of Naomi for Ruth. And through it all, their love has been the extension of God's love. It's really a book of steadfast love and faithfulness. And now in the rest of chapter 4, after Boaz's final act of love in this redemption, we'll see how God's steadfast love through all these situations now explodes in a fullness of blessing upon Boaz and then Ruth and then Naomi. We first see the redemption through Boaz, and then we'll see this explosion of blessing upon those three. And we see it in verses 7 and 8, this redemption, as Mr. So-and-so concludes his legal action with a sandal. By giving his sandal to Boaz, he's essentially saying, I relinquish my right and responsibility to redeem, and I hand it over to you. That was the significance. And so Boaz receives the sandal and declares to the elders that he has redeemed all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion and Malon. He has bought the land that they lost and brought it back into the possession of this family. And in verse 10, he also declares that he has bought Ruth out of her widowhood to be his wife. And so he has redeemed the line of Elimelech. He's preserved their lineage, Elimelech's lineage, from the looming extinction that's been over their heads throughout the book. He says that he has done this so that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brothers and from the gate of his native place. See, Boaz is doing exactly what Mr. So-and-so refused to do. He is showing steadfast love to Ruth, to Naomi, and Elimelech so that they would be cared for, that Ruth and Naomi would be cared for, and the name of Elimelech would be remembered, that his lineage would be preserved. And in response, those at the gate then bless Boaz in the name of the Lord, expressing their prayer that the Lord would make the woman coming into his house as fruitful as Rachel and Leah, whose children became the 12 tribes of Israel. They're praying ultimately, in the first place, for fertility, which wasn't a sure thing in that day. They're praying that Ruth would be fertile, that she would have offspring. And in a day where you had so many stillborn kids, where you had so many barren women, this was something that was not always a given. We even found at the beginning of the book that Ruth herself went for 10 years without ever having a child. And so they're praying that they would be fertile and have life that would come from this marriage. But this is also a prayer that from this marriage and the offspring of this marriage, this is also a prayer of significance, that there would be significance, that their children would have the same impact as the children of Rachel and Leah. And then they continue in this vein as they express their hope that Boaz would act worthily and be well known in Israel, and that his house would be like the house of Perez, who came from Tamar in Judah. Their desire is that Boaz will be seen by all as a man of valor, and that from he and Ruth, the Lord would bless them with kids and with grandkids who would have such significance that it would remind them of the men of old that God used for his own purposes. And then in verse 13, we find that their prayers begin to be answered. And we first see this with reference to blessings being poured out on the head of Boaz. We read that Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And then he went into her, and the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Now, it's hard at this point to underestimate the importance of this verse and of this birth. In fact, this is only the second time throughout the book of Ruth that the Lord is specifically said to do something. He's been active throughout the whole book, but a lot of times it's been in hidden ways, ways that we know that he's at work, but it's not explicitly said that he's at work. The only other place that it says that the Lord did something is in Ruth chapter 1, verse 6, when the Lord visited the land of Bethlehem and gave bread again to his people, gave food and life again to his people, and that brought Naomi back to Bethlehem. And here, this is only the second time throughout the book that God is said to have done something specific. And part of this, having this at the beginning, at the end, part of this is to show that throughout this whole story, God has been working. He has been the one blessing his people. Nothing has happened by accident, but he is sovereignly acting to bless his people. And part of this is to say as well that this conception in Ruth chapter 4 is no normal conception and no normal son. He has opened the womb of Ruth, even though she was barren in the past. And this son is now the son of God's steadfast love and the beginning of a lineage that would change the world. So that while Mr. So-and-so, you see, was self-seeking and his name was lost in the annals of history, the steadfast love of Boaz to redeem Ruth and Naomi has given rise to a new lineage that will never be forgotten. And that Boaz's worthiness, as they prayed for him, his worthiness would indeed be remembered throughout all Israel. In fact, Boaz's worthiness is still remembered today. We've been seeing it all throughout this series. That because of what God has done here and blessing with this son and providing this lineage, breaking in and giving life by his steadfast love, we still talk about Boaz today. That God has overflowed with grace and steadfast love because Boaz gave of himself to redeem. See, all of this is manifesting this fullness of steadfast love that is coming together with God's blessings upon his people. And in verse 13, we also see this fullness of God's steadfast love poured out upon Ruth. She began as a foreigner that Naomi hardly valued. She couldn't even give birth to a child from Malon. But though she came to Bethlehem as the lowest of the low, she was constant in her steadfast love toward Naomi and toward the Lord. She committed herself to God's people. She worked diligently in the field. She risked herself by going into the field and later going to see Boaz. And interestingly, when you follow Ruth throughout the book, though she begins as a foreigner in chapter 1 and into chapter 2, by chapter 2, she's being treated as a servant in Israel. And by chapter 3, she even becomes a servant, even a maid servant, in proposing to Boaz. And now here, in chapter 4, she is now the wife of a worthy man who has seen her worthiness, and her barrenness is gone. Ruth is now a fruitful mother in Israel, giving rise to a new age and God's purposes for his people. And then we also see the fullness of God's steadfast love being poured out upon Naomi. We find the women of Bethlehem now back on the scene as they see everything that has happened. And remember back in chapter 1 that these women saw Naomi coming into Bethlehem and they said, "Can this be Naomi?" And Naomi said, "Don't call me Naomi," which means pleasant, "but call me Mara," which means bitter. There was this awful scene and a recognition, or at least the thought of Naomi, that God was against her, that she's empty, that she has nothing. But now there's a different tune. There's a totally different scene and a different understanding of God's loving kindness toward Naomi. After the son is born to Boaz and Ruth, these women say in verse 14, "Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without a redeemer, and may his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age, for the daughter, your daughter-in-law, who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has given birth to him." And as she then takes the child on her lap and becomes his caretaker, the women then say, "A son has been born to Naomi." It's a wonderful scene where God has redeemed Naomi and done so much for her. But notice here that Boaz is not considered the redeemer. The Redeemer in these verses is the son that has been born to Ruth. He's the one who will restore her life and nourish her in her old age. Why? Because this boy who was the one who would is the one who would continue on the name of Elimelech. And now, every time she holds this baby in her arms as his caretaker, every coo, every cry, every stage of growth in his life signifies to her that God has not let her go, that he has not left her without a redeemer, that he's filled her with fullness. So that in these verses, Naomi is not only redeemed from poverty and not only given a future, but she's been redeemed from the slavery of her own bitterness, out of the shadow of her emptiness. She's been redeemed from the darkness of death that overwhelmed her and made her think that God was against her. And all of it, all of this wonderful, steadfast love of the Lord toward her has come through God's provision of Ruth, who is now declared to be even more than seven sons. See, throughout this whole story, there was this need of a son, of an heir, of someone who could provide for them and continue the family name. So at the end of the first chapter, Naomi hardly sees the value of Ruth because her husband and sons are dead and she needed them back. Ruth meant hardly anything to her. But now it is finally clear for all to see that no matter how many sons Naomi might have had, none of them could replace Ruth. See, all of these things, the blessings upon Boaz and upon Ruth and upon Naomi, have come together to show God's overwhelming and abundant steadfast love toward them. Throughout this whole section, it's the Lord who is prayed to for fruitfulness, the Lord who provides the son to previously barren Ruth, the Lord who hasn't left Naomi without a redeemer. He's done it all. And he has done it all through the steadfast love of his people. None of what we have seen throughout this book has been easy. There's been cost. There's been difficulty. There's been dark nights for Ruth and for Naomi. Fear of the unknown, of what was going on, not knowing what God was doing. But God's love, even as Naomi at times questioned his character, his love had never left them. He was always with them, and now they know it. And it doesn't end here either, because in the last section of the book, we're taken beyond the immediate context to see what's been going on all along. We have seen already the emptiness of self-seeking, and we've also seen the fullness of steadfast love, and now we see the wisdom of God's sovereign grace. This book is remarkable. For many reasons, it shows us so much about God's steadfast love and his providence toward us. But it's in these last four verses that we see just how big our God is. We find here that this son that is born to Ruth and Boaz was Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. And then we are given the genealogy from Perez, the son of Judah, to David. See, we're being shown here at the end of this marvelous book, what none of the characters could yet see. As God's redemptive grace was enjoyed by Ruth and Naomi and Boaz here, little did they know that this was but a tiny part of the eternal redemptive picture that God was bringing together. Little did they know that Obed would be the grandfather of the greatest king Israel ever had. Little did they know, when they're in the fields of Boaz, what God was doing for his people. See, our God is the ultimate multitasker. We think sometimes that we can multitask well. We do a few things, and then once we get to number three, number four, we realize how little we can do. But God accomplishes everything at once. He's working through everything that happens in this world exactly as he purposes. And here he's weaving the little details of this broken widow's life with all of her pain and loss, along with this foreigner's steadfast love and faithfulness and diligent work to her, and also Boaz's care in the fields for his people, doing all of these things, and the timing of their arrivals as well, bringing them to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley harvest and coming into specifically Boaz's field. All of it is coming together in the tapestry of God's eternal redemptive plan. It was amazing in its own context, but all of it was just a part of this grander context, because what we find in the rest of Scripture is that their sorrows and faithfulness are not only part of God's plan to save the line of Elimelech and to give an heir and rest to this family, and not only to give rest to Israel through King David, but it's also part of God's plan to bring everlasting rest to all who would trust in the heavenly descendant of David, in the Lord Jesus Christ. Which is why when we go to the opening chapter of Matthew, we find Ruth and Boaz in the genealogy of Christ. Their faithfulness in the ordinary stuff of life, their steadfast love, when it was costly, would bring about the birth of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. See, this, friends, is wisdom of God's sovereign grace. And even more, we see this wisdom not only in what God did historically to bring all these things about when Christ was born, but in how even in this story, he's pointing forward to who Christ would be and what he would accomplish. Because Ruth's inclusion in the covenant family as a foreigner was just a foretaste of what was to come in Christ. And Boaz's work of redemption was a foretaste of what was to come in Christ. Because in Boaz, God provided a kinsman who would willingly redeem at cost to himself, taking to himself a bride from the nations and granting an inheritance when it was lost through sin and death. But in Christ, as he broke into the world, taking on flesh, God has provided for all of his people a kinsman redeemer. Christ is the one who came to be like us in every respect, yet without sin. And at great cost to himself, he willingly went to the cross to take on our sin and death, to redeem us out of the slavery of our sin and out of the shadow of death, and to bring us a redemption as his bride from all nations to an inheritance that will never be stripped away. So that even now there's a song in heaven declaring, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, because by his blood he has ransomed for God a people from every tribe and language and people and nation, and has made them a kingdom and priests to God, and they shall reign on earth." Friends, we have been granted plentiful redemption in Christ, with a promise that we will reign with him in a land that's far removed from sin and sorrow and death, with death itself even be turned on his head. But until that day, we still live in the same mundane and difficult and ordinary and fallen world that Boaz and Ruth and Naomi lived in, not knowing what our lives are accomplishing in the stuff of our lives or for what purposes things happen. But we know that because of Christ, that what God did 3,000 years ago and weaving all of these little chance happenings together, that he is doing the same thing in our lives. That all of our sorrows and ailments, all of our little acts of faithfulness, our time as parents, our time as workers in our place of employment, our conversations with coworkers, the people that we see at the bank or the grocery store, all the times where we struggle and strain just to read a chapter in God's word or pray a little bit, all the little bits of life that so often feel mundane and ordinary and even useless, are being knit together into the tapestry of God's eternal and infinitely glorious plan. So that as we long for the day When the redeemed church from every tribe, tongue, people, and nation are gathered around the throne of Christ, saying, "Worthy is the Lamb," as we wait for that day, we can move forward in faithfulness, knowing that our God wastes nothing, knowing that he's working even when we can't see it, knowing that he's providing for us and others by his steadfast love and faithfulness, even in the little things of life. And in sovereign wisdom and grace, he will use all these things to bring glory to his name and good to his people. Let's pray together. Oh, Heavenly Father, we recognize that we are so small and finite, that our lives so often feel tiny. But when we look to you and to all that you do in Christ, we realize that that couldn't be further from the truth. Because when we trust in Christ and live out our lives by your Spirit, you are working to use all the little acts of faithfulness and steadfast love in our lives to the praise and glory of your Son. Father, forgive us when we don't see these things and live as we ought. And help us to see anew all that you have done for us in Christ, and to live for his glory. For we pray in his name. Amen. We'll be singing now, "O Worship the King." In the first verse, "O worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing of his power and his love." Could not be more fitting for the book of Ruth. So let us sing together and worship our King. Well, we have now come to the point where we affirm our faith together. We're in Heidelberg question 3 today. And as we have seen last week, that we need to know the comfort that we have in life and in death, and knowing Christ as our Redeemer, we need to know our guilt, we need to know his grace, and we need to move out in gratitude. And what we're going to see today and for the next several weeks is how we see our guilt. And so question 3 today, the question is this: how do you come to know your misery? The law of God tells me. The law of God shows us how we are to live as God's people, but it also shows us that in our own strength and power, without God's help, we are guilty. And the law reveals that to us. And in the weeks to come, we'll continue to see how it does that.
And now for your morning announcements. Lord willing, for the last time, because next Sunday on May 31st, we will gather once again for worship. And you can check your email from this past Friday from Pastor Zach, which outlines some of the protocol that we will follow to keep one another safe once we start meeting again. We will also communicate how you can watch our services at home. There will be a way to do it in the morning, but if you can't figure that out, the good news is that we will continue to post it on YouTube the same way that we are right now, only it'll be posted a little bit later in the day. For this week, we will continue to do the Monday Bible study where Pastor Zach is leading us through the prayers of Paul. We will still do that over Zoom, so watch your email for a link a little bit before 7 for that Zoom Bible study. For the youth, this is your last week to recite your memory work to me over Zoom to earn a king-size candy bar. Even though we're not doing the recitation of our memory work in front of the congregation, it is still very important for the youth to learn their memory work. And if you'd like to learn more about what's going on, you can check our Thursday's updates video. And Pastor Zach also has a lot of information about what the reopen will look like at that video. I know many of you, you're probably looking forward to doing a slam dunk into the offering plate next week when we're finally able to meet again. But in the meantime, you can still use the auto giving, you can still give through National Exchange Bank, and you can check the updates tab at faithreformchurch.org to learn how to do that. And the good news is that you will be able to continue giving through National Exchange even after we start meeting again if you are not able to gather on Sunday morning for worship. If you have any needs, please contact your care elder or deacon, because this is what the Benevolence Fund was set up for. There are instructions to give to the Benevolence Fund at the worship tab, on the online bulletin at our website, faithreformchurch.org. And remember, the Benevolence Fund goes to people either in our congregation or in our community who are in need at this time.
Let us now bow before the throne of our Father in heaven and bring to him all of our cares and concerns. O God of steadfast love and faithfulness, whose grace is infinite and whose love knows no end, we don't come to you as though you need something from us, but we come to you as frail children of dust and feeble as frail, so that it's you that we trust and we never find you to fail. Even when our world and our lives seem so out of control, you, O God, are in complete control, working all things together for good, working in the mundane things of life, working in our faithfulness and even redeeming our failures. And so help us, Lord, to have eyes to see all that you are accomplishing, to recognize your sovereign goodness toward us in Christ Jesus, the one who came, taking on flesh as our kinsman redeemer. And we thank you, O God, for not leaving us in the empty misery of our own sinfulness, but for buying us out of slavery to sin and making us yours, and for giving us this eternal inheritance that's imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for us, and for weaving together all the different things of our lives into your eternal and glorious plan. Help us, Father, to be a people of steadfast love, whether it's in our homes with spouses loving one another, or kids listening and caring for their parents, or at work, or in the church. Help us, O God, to be a place of love, to be a people of love, even when it's costly, giving of our lives for the good of others. Help us as we gather to worship on the 31st to be utterly unified. May the grace of our Savior drive us to be people of grace, and may next week even be a foretaste of that day when we gather around the throne with your people from all over the world and from all times. May we taste and see that you are good. And whether we're here or whether we're at home, may we be utterly unified in our worship of our Savior. Lord, we thank you for the leaders of this church that our meeting on Tuesday came to a collective decision to gather together again. And we pray that you would use our plans and purposes as leaders for the good of your people and for the glory of your name. Continue to strengthen us as leaders. Unify our hearts together. May we have a mutual love for Christ and for your people so that we would serve even as we have been served. We thank you, Lord, also for John and the youth ministry, and we ask that you would continue to be with him and other leaders in their planning this summer. It's a strange time, and so we pray that they would have wisdom, and that they would be able to make plans for the good and the building up of your church from all ages, that we would see much fruit over the summer and in the year and in the years to come. Father, strengthen also the leaders of our state and our country. We ask that you would grant wisdom and righteousness and action. Be with those who know you, who are in leadership of our state and of our country, to bear your name well and to live faithfully for Christ. Father, we also thank you for those who have served our country, that even given their lives in service, we do often take for granted the freedom that we have as citizens and even the freedoms that we have as Christians. Would you help us to be thankful to you for providing those who would even in steadfast love serve, who would even give of their own lives so that we could have freedom? And Lord, we do pray for Jaden Kettenhoven as well. Would you be with her as she serves this country? And would you strengthen her and build her up in you? Lord, we also bring before you those who are suffering from physical ailments. We pray for Florence Jordan as she recovers from surgery. May it be quick and easy, and give her your peace and knowledge, knowing that you are with her by your Spirit. We ask the same for Don with his upcoming surgery on June 17th. We thank you, O Lord, that it has been scheduled, and we pray that it be used toward his good health in the days ahead. And in all these things and more, we ask for your sovereign wisdom and grace to guide us. And as you do, Lord, would you glorify your name, build up your church, for to you belongs the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now as you go on your way, may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, and he will surely do it. Amen.